What can we do to get lawyers and the pro se litigants to spend the time to research things thoroughly and then to focus their briefs on the issues that count?
It's tough to find the time, never mind the patience, to locate the one or two good arguments buried in a pile of weak arguments.
It's not just a matter of investment of time. It's a failure to prepare. It's a failure to read the rules.
Preparing a brief for the Court of Appeals is not an easy task. Careful attention to the rules of court and hard work are essential for success. Our individual caseloads have more than doubled over the past 10 years and continue to increase every year. This is why we must emphasize the need for you to do your part in writing your brief and preparing your oral argument. This videotape should help you understand what we feel are the essential elements to a brief. We hope you enjoy it, and we look forward to your appeal.
You've done some criminal cases at your previous firm, haven't you?
Not as a lawyer, but I did a clinical program at the public defender's for a semester.
Well, here are the facts, Joseph. This is a pro bono criminal appeal. Danny Quinn is our client. He was found guilty in federal district court.
What was the charge?
Danny caught a ride home from school in a friend's car. The police stopped it, did a search, and found cocaine hidden in a suitcase in the trunk. Danny had no idea.
Sounds like an easy case to beat.
Well, it should have been. He's been sentenced to 5 years, and now he wants to appeal.
Do we have a chance?
Maybe.
Thank you for coming, Miss Alvarez.
Danny, this is my associate, Joseph Harris.
Nice to meet you, Mr. Harris.
Joseph, please.
Have a seat. Joseph is going to prepare the brief for the appeal. Under my supervision, of course.
Danny, the judgment was entered a few days ago. Tomorrow I'm planning to file the actual notice of appeal.
Danny, before we actually file the notice, I want to make sure that you understand the appellate process. Even though this case won't cost you any money because it's pro bono and you have a right to appeal, you should know that there is no sure thing. In the end, you may not win. Do you have any questions about that?
I understand. And I appreciate everything you're doing for me.
So let's get started.
What can I do to help out?
Not much right now. After Joseph files the notice of appeal, he'll prepare and file the brief. If the court needs more explanation to decide the issues, it will schedule an oral argument in front of a three-judge panel and hear from the lawyers on each side before making a decision. This whole process can take a long time.
Well, then let's get started right away.
You okay? You look nervous.
Fine.
I know you're new to our firm, but this isn't the first appellate brief you've ever written, is it?
Oh, in my last firm, I did some state court appellate work, but never anything for the Ninth Circuit.
Don't worry. You'll do just fine. I got a few pointers.
You always do.
First, get the federal rules of appellate procedure and the Ninth Circuit rules and read them. They have all the basic procedural information you'll need.
Federal rules and circuit rules. Okay, got it.
Be careful when assembling your file. Don't assume you have copies of all the documents filed in district court. Compare your file with the district court's computer-generated docket sheet. Then you'll know what to order. You are responsible for ordering all the transcripts you'll need.
Getting files together and ordering transcripts.
Next, do complete and thorough research. Oh, and don't forget about deadlines. You've got to calendar them all. Some are jurisdictional and could inhibit or even bar the appeal.
Well, that would be bad.
Not to mention malpractice.
Calendar all deadlines.
If you fail to file a notice of appeal on time, you're out. And that's your first deadline after the district court's entry of judgment.
Notice of appeal. First thing tomorrow.
Good morning. How may I help you?
I'd like to file a notice of appeal.
Well, first of all, this is the wrong court.
The wrong court? Don't the briefs get filed here?
Yes, but it's the district court where you file the notice of appeal, and you could have simply dropped it in the mail.
I'm sorry. This is my first time handling an appeal before the Ninth Circuit.
It's okay. I'll forward it. You know, sometimes when you're close to a deadline, it's not a bad idea to hand deliver your documents.
Just to the right court.
Right. Here, take a look at this. This is a docketing package. It's published by the court and contains much of the basic procedural information, like when to file the notice of appeal, how to order transcripts, fees for transcripts, designation of the record.
Thank you.
And I assume you have a copy of FRAP? The Federal Rules of Appellate,
Appellate Procedure. At the firm, yes, we have that at the firm.
They're essential. Also, you'll need to review the local circuit rules. Certain procedures apply to some circuits, but not others.
So, district court for the notice of appeal, docket package, federal rules, circuit rules, anything else?
Just give yourself plenty of time to write the brief. Good luck.
Thanks. I'll need it. Nora, you got a minute? Let me read this to you. Something's wrong.
I'm listening.
The appellant herein reiterates its position, to wit, that the appellant's freedom will be severely infringed should the verdict for the appellee subsequently stand without the remedy from the higher court, which is imperative.
Is that the end of the sentence?
What do you mean?
I didn't understand a thing you said.
The appellant herein reiterates its position, to
Honey,
wit,
come
that
on.
The appellant's...
I'm pregnant. I'm not hard of hearing.
So what's the problem?
I can't understand what you're saying.
That's because you don't understand the case.
No, it's not. Now, what's all this to wit, herein, and subsequent to stuff?
That's the way lawyers write.
Well, it's hard to understand. You should shorten the sentences and use more comprehensible language.
You don't know what you're talking about. If you were more familiar with the case, you'd understand.
Who's supposed to read this brief when you're done?
The judges, their clerks, other lawyers.
Well, and these judges and clerks, will they be familiar with the case before they read this?
Well, no, but...
Cut to the chase. Simplify your word choice. Use shorter sentences without all that legalese. Hey, you're smart. You don't need to impress them with phrases like heretofore and what was that other one?
To wit. I love that expression.
Dump it. Now, whitherest doth thou go to bed?
I get the point.
Hey, don't stay up too late, okay?
You wanted to see me?
Good morning, Joseph. Have a seat. I read your brief in U.S. versus Quinn yesterday.
And?
Well, my first impression was, wow. Looked like our case was a slam dunk, an easy reversal. Too easy. I didn't remember the facts as being so one-sided in our favor. So I took some time and I reviewed the record below, and I was right. You didn't tell the full story in your statement of facts.
But all I was trying to do
was... Every appellate judge would see through this. You can't avoid bad facts by just omitting them. This needs a lot of work.
Part of the problem was there was such a poor record made below.
You can't use that as an excuse. You're stuck with the record below.
Fine, but some of the evidence in the trial cut against us.
Joseph, don't be afraid to tell the other side of the story, the case against you. You can bolster your credibility by facing up to the facts. If you duck the hard stuff, the court will know it, and your opponent will certainly emphasize it in his responding brief.
So how do you handle the bad facts?
By surrounding them with good facts and explanation.
Sounds a bit tricky.
It's not really. Overall, your brief should concentrate on the one or two points of law that we really feel are essential to our case. We don't have to elaborate on everything that happened below, only on those things related to the issues. Focus is the key.
All right, I'll try that.
Okay. Now some specifics. You've got to weed through and order your arguments. Lead with your strongest argument first. Also, don't waste your introductory sentences. Try to summarize in two or three succinct sentences why we should win. Oh, and sometimes you fail to cite controlling precedent. Can't do that. Only rely on outside authority when the issue hasn't been addressed in this circuit. And what about critical exhibits? like the photograph of the drugs hidden in the trunk so cleverly that Quinn could never have known they were there. Use the trial exhibits in your statement of facts to prove your points. That Quinn knew nothing, and the government has failed to prove knowing possession.
I can do that.
Overall, this was too vague and unsubstantiated.
Sorry about that.
Don't apologize. Just get it right next time.
So when do you want to see next time?
Well, I'm down in federal court on Friday, and I can stop in and see Quinn then. I'll need the rewrite before then.
This is going to take a lot more time than I thought.
Welcome to the world of appellate practice, Mr. Harris.
What about an extension?
Well, it's not something the parties can just agree to.
What's the procedure?
If it's at least a week before the brief's due date, and you've never asked for a continuance before, you can get a short extension by telephoning the clerk of court. For longer extensions, you've got to file a motion. They're harder to get. If you want a second continuance or extension, you can think again. But let's try to get this in on time. Extensions don't look good, especially since we're the appellant.
Okay. I'll get right on it.
And Joseph, I'll need to see your excerpt of record.
My what?
Today is your lucky day, class. I won't be lecturing. No, instead, we have a guest lecturer. Judge Thomas Nelson from the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals will be discussing a topic that most appellate advocacy classes forget to cover. Excerpts of record. Judge Nelson?
Thank you for inviting me. Let me start out by saying that preparing the excerpts of record is one of the most difficult parts of the appellate process. The excerpt consists of selections from the record and exhibits which support your claim. It's difficult because, for one thing, the rules for compiling the excerpt periodically change. So when it's your turn to prepare an excerpt, make sure that you consult the most current guidelines. Some documents are required, like the notice of appeal and the district court docket. Other items are optional. The key is you've got to include in the excerpt all cites to the record which are found in the brief. So, to include or not to include, that is the question. Here's my rule of thumb. Let the record speak for you. Put in the important things that make your case. If it's a contract case, put in the contract. Why do people omit the obvious? Make sure that you include all pages of the reporter's transcript where the ruling or instruction is found. And be sure to include a page or two before and after to give context to your factual assertions. Remember, you're preparing the excerpt for those of us who did not attend the trial. So if you think we'll be confused by a statement or an assertion, give us the history. Don't leave us guessing. If you make a statement of fact and it's not supported in the record, the court may assume that you are twisting or manipulating the facts to support your contentions. We don't appreciate that. Also, select carefully from the motions filed in the district court. Don't just put them all in the excerpt. Nelson's golden rule, only put in those portions of documents that are cited in the brief or which are necessary for resolution of an issue on appeal. Now a few specifics. Include a table of contents in the excerpt. We want to know what's in there. Also, make sure you include the pertinent parts of trial exhibits and declarations from motions. Make a note of the trial court's exhibit number when you refer to it in the brief. And remember your page limits per volume. You can have as long an excerpt as you need, but each individual volume is limited to 300 pages. And docket sheet should be the last document in the excerpt before the certificate of service.
Why do we need to include docket sheets?
Good question. Because we can, in a glance, get a sense of what happened in the district court in chronological order. We will know what motions to look for in the district court record.
I have a more basic question. Why do we need to prepare an excerpt at all? The appellate court has the district court's file, right? Why not just photocopy the whole file? That way nobody can be accused of forgetting anything or leaving something out.
There are many documents in the district court record which have nothing to do with the issues on appeal. Besides, I'd like to see you travel the largest federal circuit by plane, covering 9 states, with the entire record from 30 cases. I'm in good shape, but not that good a shape.
This is more like it. Concise, with a nicely organized excerpt. Just don't be late filing it.
Consider it filed. Hi.
Hello.
I want to file this brief.
You didn't need to bring it here in person. You could have simply mailed it in. That's right. Just so it's postmarked by the due date. I remember you. You know, it's not really necessary for you to keep coming here in person. We encourage mailing.
I know. I just wanted to. I spent so much time working on this.
That's okay.
Do you have any idea when this will be scheduled for oral argument?
The court will send you a notice about a month before the date.
Not me, the senior partner. She'll be arguing it.
Well, put her name on the form. But remember, sometimes there is no oral presentation if the court deems it submitted on the brief.
Got it.
The government did a good job with its brief. Two strong arguments on why the verdict should be affirmed. Good one-page argument summary. They responded to your arguments in order, short and to the point. If I didn't know the case for us, I'd say it didn't look too good for Mr. Quinn.
So what's our strategy for the reply?
We want to make sure that our reply brief doesn't just restate the same facts and arguments brought out in the opening brief. Let's talk about how the district court's finding of probable cause to stop the car was clearly erroneous. And notice how the AUSA argued search incident to arrest in the brief, but not below. He can't raise it on appeal now. Point that out. Limit your reply to those two key points. But don't bring up anything outside the record or new arguments for reversal.
You mean don't sandbag your opponent?
Very unprofessional. But if the appellee has done too much damage, you can sometimes shift the focus in the reply brief from one argument to another.
Got it.
And don't forget to shepherdize just before the argument. If you find anything, you'll have to file a 28J letter.
You better call Nora and tell her she'll be eating dinner alone tonight.
Joseph, you're doing a great job. Keep it up. Joseph, just got the notice for oral argument on the Quinn case. I'm going to be out of town with Gendron versus Idaho, so I want you to handle it.
What, me?
I've already contacted Danny Quinn, and he's agreed with my decision.
I appreciate your faith in me, but I really
Look,
think...
you know the arguments and the record better than I do. Don't worry. I'm an excellent coach. It pays to be adjunct faculty. Stand behind the podium, counselor. One suggestion I have for you is to prepare an argument book.
An argument book?
Put all your answers to anticipated tough questions, all your citations to the record, copies of the case summaries, along with citations to relevant cases in a notebook. Have it ready to go before your court date. Okay, you look nervous. Don't be. In a clear, strong voice, I want to hear you address me as you would the judges of the Ninth Circuit. No reading. Be persuasive and succinct. And don't forget about making eye contact with the judges. Very important.
The appellant has been severely damaged due to the actions of the court below, which failed to instruct on the requisite prerequisites of criminal law, and further failed to rule pre-trial on the proper parameters of probable cause.
It's not a race, Mr. Harris. Slow down. And use plain English. You're not impressing anyone, sounding like what we think a lawyer sounds like. Instead, start with a 2 to 4 minute summary of your argument. Let them know where you're going with your presentation. Go on.
The law enforcement entity violated the principles of law, the Constitution, and statutory regulations with the unwarranted seizure of the vehicle within which the appellant happened to be. It is clearly obfuscation on the part of the appellee to say different.
I'm sorry to interrupt again. There's no need to get hostile. Keep your level of indignation down. The judges haven't lived with this case as long as you have. Second, don't keep using words like appellant and appellee. Use terms that amplify the point, like Mr. Quinn or the unsuspecting passenger. Let's hear some more.
Mr. Quinn, a junior college student, got a ride to his apartment from an acquaintance of his on campus. Mr. Quinn, who has no criminal history or ties, was stunned when the police stopped the car, shocked when they placed him under arrest, and surprised that his acquaintance had hidden drugs in the trunk of the car.
Good. I like that.
The government never argued that the seizure was a search incident to arrest. Under New York versus Belton, they should be precluded from raising it now.
Excuse me, I have a question. What about your probable cause challenge? Are you abandoning it? You have to be ready for the tough questions.
No, there are several reasons why the conviction should be reversed. First is the lack of probable cause to stop the car. The district court never held a hearing on the defendant's motion. The second reason is the improper instruction on the term knowing possession. Had the jury been properly instructed under any standard of review, the outcome would have been different. The Fourth Amendment was violated by the stop of the car. There was no probable cause to do so. Even so, there was no evidence linking Mr. Quinn to the contents of the trunk. Page 6 of the excerpt of record shows the way the trunk was packed. No one could have known about the drugs but the driver.
But the jury found the defendant guilty. Shouldn't we defer to them?
They did find Mr. Quinn guilty, but they were prejudiced by the improper jury instruction on constructive possession. The record shows they were not able to follow the Ninth Circuit pattern instructions or Devitt and Blackmar because they weren't given to the jury. Further, the instruction given was erroneous as a matter of law. The abuse of discretion standard does not apply. Therefore, you should reverse the conviction.
Let's review. Discuss with the client. Get and read the rules, FRAP and Ninth Circuit. Order the reporter's transcripts. Calendar all deadlines. File timely the notice of appeal in district court. Read the docketing package. It contains useful information on the appellate process. Allow plenty of time to write the brief. Extensions of time are not favored. Use shorter sentences and more comprehensible language. Remember your audience. Simplify your word choice. Avoid legalese. You can't avoid bad facts by omitting them. Rather, surround bad facts with good facts and explanation. You're bound by the record below. Focus is key. Lead with your strongest argument. Be sure to cite controlling precedent, even if it is against your position. Use critical exhibits to prove your point. Make sure you have the most current rules. Some items in the excerpts are mandatory. Include pages of the reporter's transcript where the ruling or instruction at issue is found. Golden rule. Put in all of those portions of documents that are cited in your brief or which are necessary for resolution of an issue on appeal. Include a table of contents. Each volume of the excerpts should contain no more than 300 pages. The district court docket sheet should be the last document in your excerpt. Consult with your client before filing the brief. It can be mailed in and must be postmarked by the due date. Maintain the same order of arguments as used in the appellant's opening brief. Meet appellant's arguments squarely. Keep your brief short and to the point. Don't just restate your opening brief. Use short, succinct arguments to counter appellee's arguments. Don't bring up anything outside the record. Don't sandbag. Shepherdize before oral argument. If new authority is found, send a FRAP 28J letter. Prepare an argument book that includes an outline of main points you plan to make, answers to anticipated tough questions, citations to the record, copies or summaries of key cases. Use a clear, strong voice. No reading. Be persuasive and succinct. Make eye contact. Slow down. Use plain English. Let them know where you are going. Start with a 2 to 4 minute summary of your argument. Don't get hostile about trial judge or opposing counsel. Respond directly to questions.